so I'll go ahead. And Mr. Chair, I'm going to just share my 15 minutes with John Cole Otieno and also with Dr. Sheila. So I'll be very brief with my presentation, and I'd just like to echo what my friends at the East African Center for Law and Justice and Oil River Alliance have said. So ladies and gentlemen, CitizenGo is an online petition platform which is used by citizens to defend life, family, and religious liberty. Over 26,000 citizens who have access to internet have signed a petition on the CitizenGo petition platform opposing the controversial reproductive health care bill of 2019. Over 20,000 of these signatures have already been physically delivered to the Speaker of the Senate and have been copied to the chairperson of the Senate Committee on Health and also the sponsor, who is Senator Susan Kihika. These signatures are of people and groups who represent the actual status on the ground in Kenya, and they cannot be ignored. I seek to represent thousands of citizens who, like me, have signed this petition opposing this bill. The preborn babies who ultimately are the target of this bill and cannot speak for themselves. I also want to represent children as defined in the Children's Act of Kenyan laws, and also the medics whose religious freedom is at stake, and parents who will lose big if this bill is proposed, is passed as an act. Honorable Chair, our non-negotiable stance is that this bill be withdrawn in its entirety. Some people have proposed amendments, but our position is that nothing can be salvaged in this bill, so it has to be withdrawn in its entirety. In March this year, the Senate invited memoranda from everyone taking this proposed bill, and I remember it was held at the Red Cross building. Pro-life groups or people who are opposed to abortion actually submitted their memoranda, but nothing in this bill reflects any of their positions. Honorable Chair, I'm hopeful that this time round, our positions, our presentations, our memoranda will be will count and actually will be considered. In June this year, when everybody was struggling with coronavirus and the consequences that have come with this pandemic, Kenyans were caught unawares when the controversial reproductive health care bill of 2019 was going through its second reading. The bill, which has caused outrage across the country, was being insensitively rushed through this pandemic during a time when everybody else was trying to come to terms with its consequences. Honorable Chairman, on 25th of August 2020, barely 2 weeks ago, Ipsos released a survey which gives the actual perceptions on the ground in Kenya. Over 85% of Kenyans, according to this survey, are opposed to abortion. Over 90% are opposed to homosexuality, while also over 90% think that only parents should teach their children on sex matters. Parental authority is considered by Kenyans as very, very much important. The Reproductive Health Care Bill of 2019 has focused itself in pushing for abortion in part 5 of its content, that is, the termination of pregnancy. But even when the Kenyan Constitution under 26, under Article 26, mentions itself on this particular topic, which is abortion. The inconsistency of this bill, like it has been highlighted by Advocate Joy Mudivo, on matters related to life is gruelingly huge and shocking. In the Constitution of Kenya of 2010 on right to life, every person has the right to life. That cannot be underscored. The life of a person begins at conception, and a person shall not be deprived of life intentionally, except to the extent otherwise in the Constitution or other written law. As of now, there's no any other written law that is allowing for abortion, legal abortion in Kenya. And I think by having this bill, this will be like taking advantage of this sabbatical, which is really unfortunate. Additionally, the bill tries to compel medical doctors perform or refer abortions, even when their beliefs are against abortion. To not refer could result in 3 years in jail and fines. This is an attack on religious freedom, especially on medical doctors, and Kenya being a religious country, this means that we are compelling doctors to do abortions against their will, against even their conscience, and against their beliefs. The bill also has a loophole that castigates the dignity of children or people born with disabilities. Through this bill, preborn babies that are considered to have disabilities will be expressed candidates for abortion. The proposed bill is pushing for comprehensive sexuality education through the euphemistic article on age-appropriate education. And like it has been said by World Youth Alliance, comprehensive sexuality education, I've been on the ground, my work is for life 24/7, this is what I do. And recently, in January of last year, we stopped the push of comprehensive sexuality education in Kenya. I have that curriculum that is called What Starts With Me. The contents are glaringly disturbing, because the content, chapter by chapter, they are pushing for masturbation for children aged 5 years old. They are pushing for experimenting with gender. You can experiment whether you're male or you're female at the age of five. You can also experiment on matters of contraception. You are taught that abortion is a right, and you're taught that parental authority is not important when you're making decisions on abortion and contraception as a child from age five. I have the curriculum, and I'll be very proud to share with the Senate Standing Committee on Health if this is important, so that you can see the danger that this bill is exposing, especially to our children and to the parents in this country. The bill also pushes for surrogacy, even when not offering a framework for the same. We have seen how surrogacy is being practiced in developing countries like India, and it needs a lot of consideration, a lot of framework to be able to even think about having legal surrogacy in the country. It also pushes for in vitro fertilization, which is a very unethical shortcut to solving infertility issues. The name of the bill, which is Reproductive Healthcare Bill, is drawn from the United Nations language definition, which means everything abortion. The spirit of this bill is thus unacceptable and contradicts the Kenyan constitution on matter it seeks to address. As much as we are concerned, the people who have signed the citizen group petition, this bill is not trying to address any gap, as there is already an existing policy addressing matters reproductive health, which was drafted by the Ministry of Health with the consultation of all stakeholders. And I want to underline the consultation of all stakeholders, because the Ministry of Health has involved everybody when they tried to, when they were actually drafting this bill. I mean the policy, but this bill is not representing everybody. Personally, it doesn't represent me. It doesn't represent a lot of stakeholders, and that is why you are seeing there's a lot of outcry out here. So there's no need to have a bill that is representing just a section of people in this country. The rush to pass this bill, whose main agenda is to legalize abortion at a time that our youth need a solution to unemployment due to coronavirus. When our rural areas need passable roads, when our villages need electricity, when even the hospitals themselves still need to be improved, it's a proof of watered priorities by the Senate and the sponsors of this bill. Honorable Chairman, I implore on you and also the members of this committee to take advice. I'm not sure which is your modest way of transport, maybe a helicopter, to any village in Kenya and ask the women down there what their needs are. And I want to assure you that 99% of them will ask for anything less, but not abortion, but not for contraception, but not for comprehensive sexual education. They'll ask for anything else, but not what is in this bill. So the question will ultimately be, by passing such a law, whose interests are we serving? Finally, Honorable Chairman, so that I can give John Paul Otieno and Sheila some minutes, with the help of God and that of Kenyan women and men who believe that life is sacred, that abortion hurts women, and thus making this bill anti-women, we are determined to fight this bill if it goes through this committee stage to the third reading. We are praying that you do the right thing, which is to withdraw this bill at this stage and draft a bill acceptable by at least the majority of Kenyans. As at now, this bill is only representing less than 15% of Kenyans, and that is why you see this resistance. Thank you, and God bless Kenya. So I'm going to invite John Paul through you, Honorable Chairman.
Thank you. But let me just note here that please, we are not fighting anybody. We are not coming here to throw words at anybody. We are coming here to listen to everybody. So please, let's respectfully put your opinions. We are listening to everybody. We are not going against anybody. We don't have a preconceived position. That's why we've called for these stakeholders to come and listen to you. So if you come here with your thinking that already there's a position, then you're in the wrong place. So we hear you. Take all your matters into consideration with all due respect, and we also deserve the same respect from you. And let's listen and see what we can do together. So 5 minutes, John Paul, good to see you, Senator.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Bwana Chair. Thank you for allowing us to be here. And thank you for all the presenters who've gone ahead. I'm very happy and grateful. The thing I'd like us to see as leaders is we now have an opportunity to deliberate on this bill, to contribute towards the context of this bill. But what will happen thereafter, we have no authority. Our powers are limited up to the time it passes. So the question is, what type of addressing? As leaders, we feel privileged to be involved in this process, because any decision we make here will completely rewrite the history of our country with far-reaching effects. Either it will be rolling down towards a particular direction which we don't want, or it will escape the trap that we perceive to have been laid. The moment it passes, then it will be in the hands of the advocates and the court of law to interpret, and they will not interpret it according to our intention or the intention of the others, but with respect to the text, whatever is written there. And the question is, would it be interpreted in a way that promotes life? Would it be interpreted in a way that we would be proud of? What legacy will it leave for us, and what consequences is it likely to bring in? As has been said, is we in Kenya, some people have questioned whether Kenya is really a religious country. And the truth is, we are religious. Right from the preamble of our constitution, we're able to see that we, the people of Kenya, acknowledging the supremacy of the Almighty God. You can see that even at the start of this session, in any other session, we start by prayer. And everything that we do, we have it in our national anthem, O God of all creation. We have it in the East African anthem and everything else. So we must always try to ensure that every law that we pass are consistent with that. We've said that life begins at conception in our constitution. It means everyone who is conceived is a person. And so the contemplation of terminating that life goes against the same spirit and the same context of the law. And the other thing is there is this element of any other written law. Yeah, when we are talking about abortion, and some other people talk of safe abortion, there cannot be something safe when somebody is killed. There cannot be anything safe when after that, the mother requires some treatment. There is some blood that is coming out. There is nothing safe in that. Somebody has lost life. And if you see this element of, that is Article 26, part 4, that says any other written law, this is the window that the pro-abortion are using to bring in the legalization of this particular element. Even the bit of some other people have talked about what if it is as a result of rape. Yes, but why do we punish the innocent for the sins of somebody else? This bill is not about rape. It is about reproductive health care, and it's not anything to do with that. If there is any need for rape and something like that, and there is no such law, which I believe there is, then we can talk about that. When we talk about children that are believed to be deformed or somewhat incompatible with life outside the womb, then something is wrong there, because it means we are bringing in the element of discrimination, which goes against Article 27 of our Constitution. There is no mercy killing or euthanasia in Kenya. And we believe that children are gifts from God, God of all creation. Then if they are a gift from God, we cannot say return to sender. We do not want this. We want you to bring us another. No. That doesn't go with the spirit of Kenyans. If there is need about establishing the truth, because having listened to most of the proponents of these in their debates outside and marketing their position, they talk about things like economic problems with people, so they need to plan families and things like that, and they are using things like information. They want the youth to make choices for whatever they want. The question is, do we leave the children to make a democratic choice on what they want, or parents need to be of assistance? Parents need to guide them, and we may need, honorable members, our leaders, we may need at some point, if possible, to get a referendum to get rid of this any other law, be it, so that we amend this, because the idea is, we remember even from the time we were debating the Constitution, that these same people pushed for this to be there. There is nothing that would occasion the intentional termination of life. And so there is need to get rid of that. The other thing I would request, honorable members, is to ensure that we can dig into the details of what's pushing this rush, what is making this rush, what is making this thing so urgent, while there is nothing new that is being introduced. In actual fact, if they keep pushing, we may need to have a referendum altogether to ask the whole Kenya, to ask all the Kenyans on what they really want, as opposed to pushing in some interest that we perceive to be foreign to our ideologies, to our culture, to our religious practices. Somebody talks about whether we love women and want to give them choice. Whether we want to give them choice to make decisions with their bodies. Yes, their bodies, and we love them. We know they have a choice to make, to conceive, because conception is not an accident. Every woman knows or can be made to know exactly when they can conceive, and the prerequisites for that. It's just a simple biology like drinking water. And so it's not an accident. And that is the decision we want everyone to be able to make. That's the choice that every individual and every couple, in this case, we want to talk about couples and not just people out there, need to make when they want to have a conception, or when they do not want to have a conception. But after that, we should not terminate any life out of some other person's recklessness. It just doesn't sound fair. And the other question we would like to ask is what's the motivation behind the people who seem to be so determined to introduce this? When we talk of age appropriate, I'm just trying to summarize, age appropriate information to the adolescents. We've seen that this age appropriate in itself can be something that is mutilated. It's something that is undefined, it's vague. And that is now what has caused things like what we saw in the Western Kenya last week, where children are given some contraceptives and even their parents have no idea about them. And nobody talks about the negative consequences of these contraceptives. Our humble prayer is, let there not be a rush. Let's stop this process, and if need be, let's reevaluate and subject it to the whole Kenyans so that they make a choice, but not the interest of some of the people being pushed. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. We hear you, and we'll put your ideas and considerations into consideration. And let's move on, please. Let's move to the next. Is Fida ready?
Yes, I'm ready. Good morning, Chair. Yeah, that anger, the sadness that she feels. Usually, when we have a loss, we usually go through rituals to be able to help us process that sense of loss. But when it comes to an abortion, because of the secretive nature of it, because of the challenge of being able to hide that secret, you find that this woman harbors that pain and that sense of grief within herself and carries that as an emotional wound that she goes with everywhere she goes, and this impacts, you know, so many different areas of her life. So emotionally, sometimes she can be vulnerable to depression, to anxiety. We've even had instances of people just wanting to harm themselves and just struggling to really understand what's happening with them internally. We also find socially, you know, this woman can become very secretive. She feels like she's carrying a label on her head saying, you know, I did this, and kind of hides away from the world and withdraws from people. Within relationships, she's very vulnerable to enter into relationships where she, because she doesn't feel really worthy and has a sense of shame, she becomes vulnerable to put herself in relationships where she's vulnerable. So we've had people who get into domestic violent relationships where they are victims because of this sense of wanting to punish themselves. There's this feeling like I did something wrong and so I deserve punishment. And so she finds herself in these kinds of self-punishing behaviors, including getting into those kinds of relationships. Also, as a mother, you find that this woman sometimes doesn't feel like a real mother if she has her own children. She may not be able to bond with her children, or she may become overprotective of her children. When it comes to her own sense of femininity, she feels inferior to other women. And bottom line, she's not able to fully contribute to the well-being of society because of all these internal wounds that she holds. And then another big thing that's been brought up repeatedly is the impact on the adolescent and the child. And so you think about this young child or adolescent who is vulnerable to be able to have emotional challenges because she made a decision at a young age that continues to have an impact on her even as she continues in her journey of life. And so for me as a clinical psychologist, I want to advocate that we really need to look out for the mental health of these women, of families, of these children, because the effects of that carry on beyond that decision and have impacts or the kinds of people or the kinds of Kenyans that we are anticipating to contribute to the well-being of this nation. So please look out for the mental health of these individuals. Thank you.